Hello and welcome everybody back to lecture video 8.2. In this video we will introduce sine distance functions, and in particular we will then show an algorithm that uses sine distance functions to track the pose of a quadrilateral in real time and create simultaneously a 3D textured map of its surroundings. And before we start with the technical details, let me first show you this video. This is an Aztec quadrilateral called Pelican. And it has a 3D depth camera on board, and it now uses the images of this 3D depth camera to generate a 3D model of its surroundings, and at the same time estimates then its position, its 3D pose in real time, and uses that for position control. And in the remainder of this video I will show you how this works and how this can be done. And this now here is a visualization of the flight trajectory. Actually, you can see that it's quite shaky. The quadrilateral did not follow nicely a certain path. But nevertheless, the algorithm is able to run, and the quadrilateral follows the predefined path. So this is our platform in more detail. Can see it's also a quadrilateral. It has four rotors. It has an autopilot board in the middle that does attitude control and contains the IMU. And then on top we have mounted an RGBD camera. The good thing about this Pelican platform is that it can carry up to 600 grams of additional payload, so you can add more sensors as you wish. And we then decided to add an RGBD camera. It's similar to Microsoft Kinect, just a little bit more lightweight. It contains a full computer running Ubuntu. We have now an Intel Core 2 Duo, but they also sell it with an i5, so you can have really reasonable performance. And in the video that you've seen before, we've used this onboard PC for Kalman filtering and the autopilot board for position control. But we still had an external computer that was running the 3D mapping, because at the moment we need a graphics card for it. Good. So just to give you a brief outline of what depth cameras are and how they work. This is how this ASUS camera looks like. It consists of two cameras, namely an infrared camera and a color camera. And the infrared camera looks at the scene, but it where it sees the normal infrared image, but it also sees a dot pattern that is projected by the sensor itself from a slightly different location. And then this pair of the infrared pattern projector and the infrared camera forms a so-called stereo baseline, which gives us the possibility then to compute the depth of every pixel, so the distance of every pixel from the sensor. And there are different sensing principles for generating such depth measurements. Stereo cameras and structured light cameras like this one match two images, so either a reference image that you already know from your projector, or you just observe two independent images with a stereo camera and then you try to match them. Or you have direct measurement principles where you measure the time of flight of a light pulse that you're sending out the time until it returns. Good. So before we now present our algorithm, we thought that it would be nice also to present a little bit what happened before. We are using sine distance functions here, and they've actually been introduced by Curlis and Levoy for 3D reconstruction already in 1996. The basic idea here is that they represent the distance to the surface in a voxel grid. You'll see later an illustration of what that actually means. And they already ran at that time a data fusion of multiple depth images into a 3D model. But they didn't do camera tracking, and of course it was also not running in real time at this time. This changed dramatically with the appearance of Kinect. And then the first algorithm that showed that you could really do nice 3D reconstructions was Kinect Fusion. So I really recommend that you Google for Kinect Fusion, or follow the link at the end of the video to look at the original Kinect Fusion video. It was for the first time that people showed that you can get really nicely looking 3D reconstructions in real time from the Kinect. So Kinect Fusion uses ICP to track the camera pose. ICP stands for iteratively closest point, and it's a very common and popular algorithm to align two point clouds. The problem here is, of course, that we don't have point clouds, or we have one point cloud from the sensor, but we represent the model using this sine distance function. So Kinect Fusion emulates a synthetic depth image, a synthetic point cloud, and then aligns these two using ICP. And then we said that this is of course not optimal because you need to emulate a depth image, so can't we do that more direct? And then we came up with this idea to estimate a camera pose directly using the sign distance function. And as you will see, this is a very efficient way and even more accurate than if you would first have to go via a synthetic depth image and then run ICP on that. So now let's look at what sign distance functions actually are. And for that, imagine that we have a house that we want to reconstruct in 3D. And then we could define a function that has the value of 0 exactly at the location of the surface of the house, that has negative values outside of the house and positive values within. And of course, we can't represent a continuous function very well in a computer, so we would just sample this function in a grid, and then this would give us a sine distance grid. And now, in this example, for example, the blue cells are the negative cells outside of the object, and the positive cells with positive distances are within the object. And now the next step, of course, is that we need to compute this sine distance function from depth images. For the moment, we just try to compute it for a single depth image, and then we'll extend it later to multiple depth images. So the problem is that we want to estimate the value of all cells of our sine distance function. And that means that for every cell, we have to estimate its distance to the surface. Now, computing the Euclidean distance is rather involved computationally, but a very simple approximation to that is the so-called projective distance that you can just evaluate by projecting this every cell into the view of the camera, and then looking up the depth value that you've actually observed at this point, and then you can take the difference between these two and then have an observed projective distance. This is not the same as the Euclidean distance, but it's good enough, at least if your opening angle is narrow enough, and this is why we decided to use that. And now the next step, of course, is that we have multiple depth images, so every voxel is observed multiple times. And now what we do is we compute a weighted average over all these measurements, which means that at every voxel we have to keep the sum or the average sum, the average distance, and the sum of all weights. And then with every new depth image we can just update these two values. And then we can do the same actually also for the color, so we can compute the weighted average of every voxel in the color space. And so for now, we have assumed that we already know the camera poses. That's of course not true when we have a flying quadrotor, but we will look at this in a second. But first, let's look at how to actually visualize then a sine distance volume. There are different algorithms for doing that. Kinect Fusion used ray casting, and a different method is to extract a mesh from it. A mesh has the advantage later that you can easily import it in other programs, like a CAD program, for example, then you can actually take measurements within your volume. And one very popular algorithm for extracting a mesh from a sine distance function is called margin cubes. And the basic idea behind this is that we need to find the zero crossings in the sine distance function, because we know that whenever the sine changes, we know that there must be a surface somewhere in between. We're switching from outside the object to inside the object. And then what margin cubes does is to interpolate the distance values of both of these voxels to find exactly the location of the estimated surface. And with that, you get a really good resolution that's typically much higher than your voxel grid resolution. And so you're getting much smoother surfaces. And this works, of course, in 2D, then it's called marching squares, but it also works in 3D, and then it's called marching cubes, because you're looking at a cube, one cube at a time. And this gives you then vertices and faces that you can save to a file, for example. Your mesh is then represented as a list of triangles. Good. Now, the next step now is that we need to estimate the camera pose. So, and for that, we assume that we have already built the sine distance function from the first k frames. So this means in the very beginning, we would assume that we know the initial pose of the quadrotor, say it could be located at the origin. And then with every next frame, we continue as follows. So we're initializing then the sine distance function from the first frame or from the first k frames. And then we get a new camera frame for which we don't know the camera pose. Of course, you could make a first prediction, maybe just by assuming that you have constant velocity, so you're moving in the same direction that you moved before, but or you just assume zero velocity, initializing it with the previous pose. And then the depth camera gives you a surface in 3D, and now our goal, of course, is to align the surface to the surface that is stored in our sine distance function. And now Kinect Fusion actually does this as follows. It simulates a synthetic depth image from your current estimate of your camera pose, and then runs ICP between the two to find the right camera pose. And this is actually not necessary because what ICP then in the end is doing, it's again computing distances of your reference model to your target model. And this is actually not necessary. So we realized then when we were looking at that you can actually directly use the sine distance function to read out these distances. So if you look very clearly now, every point of the green line should fall or should coincide with the zero crossing that we have in the sine distance function. And when it is not lying on the same on the zero crossing, then our camera pose is not yet correct. So what we try to achieve is to make this green line match exactly the black line, and for that we can formulate an energy function as follows. So every point, every pixel on the depth image can be projected into a 3D space given a certain rotation and a translation, and that gives us then a 3D coordinate in the world frame. And for this 3D coordinate, we can look up the distance value from our sine distance function. We can then square it, for example, if we assume that the noise is normally distributed, or apply any other robust norm, and then sum these distance values, or these costs over all pixels I and j. And we of course seek to minimize this sum, because we know that our minimum should be at the place where this green line coincides with the zero crossing in the sine distance function. And we minimize that using Gauss-Newton method, similar to what the KLT tracker has actually been using. And of course, when you optimize something like this, remember that you want to have a minimum representation. So it makes sense to represent this rotation matrix R here as angular velocities, for example, because then you have only 3 degrees of freedom instead of 9 components of a rotation matrix. Good. And then we can actually use this concept to perform mapping with the quadrotor. So as we said before, we equipped the quadrotor with a depth camera, and then we feed the depth images that we get, we load them onto an external computer. Just because the onboard PC is not strong enough to do that at the moment. We update the sine distance function, and then estimate the next camera pose. And then we feed back this camera pose to position control that then again runs on the quadrotor, and that uses it then to follow a trajectory. And then actually only as a side product, we obtain this 3D model from the sine distance function, even with color, that we can then use, that then an architect could use to show how a room looks like. And just to give you a few more examples, these are some of our lab spaces here in Munich. So here we flew a small rectangular shape with the quadrotor in one of the labs. And this gives us then this 3D model of the world. You can recognize some of the desks. But the important thing here is that this automatically has the right scale because the Kinect sensor has a fixed baseline, and so we know about the scale of the world. And so an architect could directly measure the height of a table or the distance between walls. This is another corner that we have in our lab to SOFA. So if you're ever close to Munich, then please visit us, and then you can see these SOFAs and the lab for real. Good. And the interesting thing then is that you can actually not only use that for 3D room scanning with a quadrotor and position control, but for the algorithm itself, it does not matter whether you're scanning a room or you're actually scanning an object or a person. And so we figured that we could actually also use that to scan persons in 3D. In this case, we put the person on a chair, on a swivel chair that we rotate slowly. And you can see in the upper left corner, there is the action sensor. And on the screen, you get immediately a 3D model of the person. This part now of the video shows that in a little bit more detail. You can see how the 3D model is carved out while the camera is apparently is virtually moving around the object. Of course, the object rotates, but for the algorithm, it doesn't matter whether the camera moves or the world moves. And then a cool thing is this is a visualization of the underlying voxel grid. The cool thing then is that you can also modify this assign distance functions very easily. So you can add components like this socket, for example, and you can make a model hollow on the inside. And there is a good reason why you want to do that, because the interesting thing is that you can actually print these models then in 3D and in color. And that gives very nice figures that you can then put in a bookshelf or give to your parents as a present. So this is a very simple technique to make 3D scans of objects. It can be a person, it can also be a room. And for this particular project, we even launched a website called fablitech.com. And if you're interested to try this out for yourself, then please navigate there and download a demo version. Good. So to sum this up, today we've looked at depth cameras in combinations with quadrotors. We've introduced sine distance functions at very powerful representations for 3D space when you're dealing with depth cameras. We've looked at methods to track the camera pose with respect to a sine distance function. And we've shown that we can actually use that for position control of the quadrotor. And just as a side product here, this gives us, as I said, with marching cubes, in combination with marching cubes, a mesh that we can then post-process either by loading it into a CAD program to take measures of a building or to use it for person scanning and then for person printing.